Sí, como si cuando quieras.
Show me the tool.
So if we want to get started,
Great.
we can get started. So, well, first of all, thank you so much for having us and for making the space on a Saturday to be with us here. My name is Uriel, and I'm joined by my compañero Oscar from the Coalition. And we're just excited to connect with you all again. So I'll give it away to Oscar.
Yeah. Ya, como dijo Uriel, gracias por hacer el espacio y por darnos la oportunidad de pues hablar un poquito sobre Imokalee, hablar un poquito sobre la situación que sucede acá.
Yeah, so like Uriel mentioned, first of all, thank you so much for giving us the time and the space to be able to share with you all about the situation and about the work here in Imokalee, Florida.
Creo que es difícil de acostumbrarnos todavía de poder tener las mascarillas. Nosotros lo tenemos que hacer cuando estamos cada vez aquí en la oficina, al igual que cuando estamos con la comunidad.
Yeah, and we know that all of us are adjusting and finding it difficult, right, to make those adjustments during the time of COVID right here. And Imokalee, we have become accustomed to using our face mask anytime we're in the office or anytime when we're out in the community, right, to sort of set an example.
Pero al mismo tiempo, adelantando todo, quiero agradecer porque la iglesia sabemos que siempre a lo largo de nuestra campaña nos ha apoyado y ha apoyado también esta comunidad.
But yeah, getting to more about you all and stuff. First, you know, one thing that I want to say is just how grateful we are always that your congregation and everyone at First You have just been very supportive of our work throughout the years now.
Imokalee es esa comunidad que ha luchado desde los años 90, luchando en contra de las injusticias que pasan o que pasaban dentro de los campos, luchando siempre en contra de los patrones y de las compañías agrícolas.
Yeah, so to sort of kick it off, for those that may not know, and we're going to give a little bit of an introduction, I would add. So here with the Coalition of Imokalee Workers, our organization was established here in Imokalee, Florida, to address a lot of the injustices and abuses that farm workers were facing in our community when doing this work.
Abusos, por ejemplo, de lo que son el robo de salario, abuso y maltrato físico y verbal, el acoso sexual, en casos más extremos, esclavitud, como la coalición ha tenido un papel importante para investigar, procesar y apoyar a los trabajadores en esos casos.
Yeah, and when we talk about abuses, we talk about things like wage theft, rampant wage theft in the industry, verbal and physical abuse, conditions for farm worker women of sexual violence, and in some of the most extreme cases, cases of what we would call modern day slavery. The CIW has played a role in investigating and prosecuting these about 9 cases of modern day slavery, freeing thousands of workers through this work.
Haciéndolo, enfrentando todos estos problemas o abusos, haciéndolo de la manera más pacífica posible.
Yeah, and all of the time of trying to create this change or bring about this change in the most pacifist or sort of the most pacifist way as possible.
Y creo que esa es una de las cosas bastante bonitas de nuestro movimiento, de que desde el principio de la coalición hasta ahora, nuestras acciones son solamente son pacíficas. Son maneras en la cual podemos crear o buscar un cambio directamente con la gente que tiene poder.
Mm-hmm. And that's probably one of the most beautiful things about the movement and my participation in this movement, and that is that since its inception, has always been a movement based on pacifist sort of methods and really just trying to get at the heart and creating change with the people in power.
Por ejemplo, en los años pasados o en los años 90, la coalición hizo un paro laboral aquí en la comunidad. Un paro laboral pidiendo respeto hacia los trabajadores. De los trabajadores hacia los contratistas.
Yeah, an example of this is in the 1990s, in the early years of the coalition, one of the actions that they took on was a work stoppage here where workers would refuse to get on the buses to go to the fields unless the conditions that they were facing were better.
Hicieron marchas también, que en una de esas marchas usaron una camisa de un trabajador que fue golpeado en los campos con el simple hecho de tomar agua. Esa camisa del trabajador lo utilizaron como una bandera para poder marchar aquí en el pueblo y llegar hasta la casa del contratista.
We have done many marches. One of the earliest marches that we did was in an instance where a 60-year-old farm worker was physically assaulted in the workplace. He came to our offices in a bloodied shirt. And this shirt was sort of used as a flag by farm workers to march towards the house of the abusive crew leader who had physically assaulted this worker. And so, yeah, that's one of those early actions that happened in the
O
90s.
la huelga de hambre, que compañeros, precisamente en una fecha como ahora, mes de diciembre, ellos hicieron una huelga de hambre de 30 días, y eso es una acción bastante pacífica, pero con un mensaje bastante claro por qué trabajadores de Imokalee queríamos un diálogo con los rancheros, por qué hacia los rancheros y por qué es que como trabajadores sabíamos que ellos son una parte de las condiciones que viven los trabajadores.
Yeah, and one of the other actions that is well known in the early years is a 30-day hunger strike taken by six farm workers, again, a pacifist action with the main focus of trying to start a dialogue with farm owners, with the people that own the fields where a lot of these abuses were happening. And this is where we started realizing sort of the hierarchy within the structure of agriculture, the need for there to go to people above, or people in places of power in order to create the change that was necessary.
Eso es básicamente un poco de lo que es la historia de nuestra organización. En 10 años, del 90 hasta el 2000, se hicieron todas esas acciones, pero también se hicieron lo que es las juntas comunitarias aquí con la comunidad, las visitas a los campos, las maneras de cómo integrar a la comunidad que sufre todos estos abusos.
Yeah, and so that's a little bit about the history, really, from the early 90s to the 2000s, about 10 years scope in terms of what we were doing. But in reality, there was so much more. And one of the other things that was happening was really just in trying to involve the farm worker community in this struggle, right? That they participate, that they feel comfortable in speaking out and naming the problems that they were facing. But also in saying there needs to be a change that needs to come about.
Pero esa parte de la historia para nosotros es siempre importante por el hecho de que cuando uno recuerda de dónde uno viene y al ver todo lo que hemos logrado hasta ahora, nos damos cuenta que hemos venido avanzando en términos de derechos laborales, en términos de cómo apoyar a la comunidad, en términos de cómo hemos visto el apoyo de iglesias, universidades, la gente de la comunidad, aprendiendo siempre sobre las cosas que estamos logrando como organización.
Yeah, and to us, it's important to remember this history because it reminds us of where we came from, of where the conditions were in the past, and how things have been able to get better, and what it took to get it to change. The involvement of faith allies, the involvement of people from different communities coming together in this struggle and saying that enough is enough and doing something to support workers.
Y sabemos que en Columbus tenemos un apoyo bastante grande y de gente como ustedes que en alguna ocasión ha estado en nuestras acciones, por ejemplo, la de Wendy's, pero detrás de todo eso también hay otras corporaciones que han entrado en base al entendimiento, en base a que cómo los trabajadores hemos logrado dar a entender la importancia que hay para que el consumidor se una al programa, se una para apoyar.
And we know that many of you obviously have participated, and we have a lot of support in Columbus. A lot of you have participated in our campaign with Wendy's. But before that, we know that there has been a long history, right, of trying to convince many other corporations before Wendy's that they needed to do something, right, and to get them to actually acknowledge the conditions that farm workers were facing within their supply chains.
Por ejemplo, la razón por qué nosotros tenemos la campaña por comida justa, la razón que vamos hacia las corporaciones y pedimos a ellos a pagar un poquito más por los tomates, a hacerse responsables de las condiciones que pasan en el trabajo. La razón de todo esto es por la misma explotación que existe en esta comunidad.
Yeah, and the main reason why we've taken to asking and demanding these penny more per pounds to sign these legally binding agreements is rooted on the exploitation that has historically happened in our community and towards farm worker communities in general.
Si ven la cubeta que está en la pantalla con el trabajador, esa es la herramienta de trabajo y es así como se llena los tomates, o es así como se carga la cubeta, y esa cubeta es hasta en los años 90 es pagado 40, 45 centavos. Hasta estos años, más o menos unos 10 años, ha aumentado un poco el salario del pago de esta cubeta por el mismo hecho de que la campaña ha cambiado esa manera de pago.
And one of the ways that we can see this change is with the image that you see right in front of you right now. This image has a farm worker with the tool of the farm worker, right? This is this bucket that when it's totally full holds about 32 pounds of tomatoes. When it's totally filled. And farm workers, I would add, earn by the amount of buckets that they pick, right? They earn what we call the piece rate. And so in the 90s and early 2000s, when the CIW really started taking on or started really this campaign, farm workers were getting paid anywhere between 40 to 45 cents for each bucket of tomatoes that they were picking. Very low wages in terms of how much these buckets end up being worth in stores, I would add. But it was, again, through the Campaign for Fair Food that we've been able to create an increase to the per bucket rate for farm workers so that they could see a real wage increase in really about 30 years in the industry here.
Entonces, por eso la petición que tenemos, que hemos tenido hacia las corporaciones, por ejemplo, Taco Bell en el principio de los 2000, el centavo más por libra, el código de conducta donde hay cero tolerancia al acoso sexual y cero tolerancia a la esclavitud, la voz y la participación de los trabajadores en decisiones que quieran hacer las compañías. Esas demandas que se hicieron de parte de los trabajadores son importantes para que hoy podemos decir que estamos en una sociedad de una industria donde todos cuentan, todos somos partes dentro de una industria y todos tenemos una voz ahí.
And that's why when we started the campaign with Taco Bell and continuing on, the demands were really simple. A penny more per pound of tomatoes that each corporation purchases, that penny go directly to farm workers as an added bonus for the work that they're doing. A zero tolerance policy, human rights-based code of conduct created by farm workers themselves, with zero tolerance towards sexual violence, towards modern day slavery. And the third demand, for there to be the voice and participation of farm workers in the implementation of these rights in the fields, so that workers can freely speak out anytime that they're facing an abuse. And so for that reason, we saw these three demands as really leveling out the playing field in the agriculture industry and giving basic human rights to farm workers in their workplace.
14 corporaciones han entrado en el programa apoyando los cambios que queremos los trabajadores.
Yeah, since those early days of Taco Bell, 14 corporations have signed on to these three demands that the Immokalee farm workers have created.
Estas corporaciones han estado trabajando ahora junto con nosotros también para empezar a implementar los cambios directos que los trabajadores puedan tener en el trabajo.
And these 14 corporations are working alongside us to implement on the fields, on the ground, the true changes in the farms where they purchase from.
Por ejemplo, educamos a los trabajadores, a miles de trabajadores que están trabajando en compañías que están dentro del programa.
And what that has looked like, as you can see from this image, is educating over 250,000 farm workers within these farms participating in the Fair Food Program about the rights that they're entitled to.
Cuando decimos educamos, es que nosotros como miembros de la organización vamos a los campos y explicamos a los trabajadores los derechos que contiene un librito pequeño, que son derechos básicos, pero que en la industria agrícola antes de todo no se respetaba y no se enforzaba y no se implementaba para los trabajadores.
Yeah, and when we talk about education, what we mean is that farm workers like Oscar go to the farms participating in the Fair Food Program and talk about this little booklet. We hand out these little booklets where it talks about what rights and protections farm workers are entitled to and letting them know about what rights they have, but also what mechanisms exist for them to be able to voice any concerns that they have.
Hemos venido haciendo estas pláticas con los trabajadores por 9 temporadas.
We've now been doing these education sessions for 9 years now, 9 seasons.
Esta semana, por ejemplo, yo estaba en los campos con los trabajadores haciendo esa plática. Y el jueves me tocó estar con un grupo que participaba mucho y que hablaba sobre las condiciones que ahora son diferentes.
Mm-hmm. And this week, actually, I personally went out to one of the farms to be part of one of the education sessions. And when I was out there on Thursday, I managed to find a group that was very, very participatory in terms of voicing, right, the changes that they now see in the fields that they're working in.
Al finalizar la plática, donde lo cerramos siempre con la responsabilidad que tienen los trabajadores de usar estos derechos a favor de ellos, pero sin tomar ventaja.
And when we finalize the education session, we usually talk about the responsibilities that each farm worker has and how this, again, levels the playing field and doesn't give anyone an advantage in the workplace.
Y al finalizar la plática, todos los trabajadores se van suben para el autobús, pero antes de subirse, pasaron a agarrar uno de estos nuevos libritos porque tiene una parte sobre el COVID.
So usually after the talk, each worker gets one of these handbooks and, you know, sort of goes off. But this time it was especially important for them to grab each book, because now there's new protocol with regard to coronavirus, right? Everything that we are now facing as well.
Y antes de que uno de los trabajadores, antes de que subiera el bus, voltea y nos dice, como tomando distancia, nos dice, muchas gracias por venir acá. No se olviden de nosotros nunca, por favor.
And one worker, when he was sort of walking away, he looked at me and turned and he said, you know, thank you for coming here. Never forget about us that are working here in the fields and doing this work.
Esos comentarios no se escucharían si los trabajadores no se sienten cómodos de poder expresarse dentro de una compañía.
Yeah, these kind of comments we see as an example of how workers are now comfortable to speak in their own workplace, and how there isn't sort of retaliation against them voicing these sorts of things.
Estos son los ejemplos cuando uno piensa sobre el programa de comida justa, cuando uno piensa sobre cómo las corporaciones tienen esa responsabilidad de hacer los cambios. Esas son las oportunidades donde a uno como trabajador lo humaniza por el hecho de que estamos viviendo en un tiempo diferente y en una nueva sociedad dentro de este trabajo.
These kinds of comments is what gives us, or verifies really, that the approach that we're going about is the correct approach of getting these corporations to take on the responsibility of workers within their supply chains. But really what it adds is a level of humanity, right? As a human being, you hear and you connect with another human being and seeing and them telling you that they're being respected, that they value what you're doing, that they value the education that you're offering them, is really important to us.
Estas estadísticas que ustedes ven en la pantalla son un poquito pasadas. Mm-hmm. Pero hasta ahora, por ejemplo, se han resuelto cerca de 3,000 quejas que han entrado bajo el programa. Trabajadores que han que siguen en las compañías y trabajadores que están mucho más cómodos ahí trabajando.
Yeah, these figures that you see in your screen are a little outdated now. They are August 2019. Today, we have received closer to 3,000 complaints that have been, again, successfully resolved in a matter in a short time without any retaliation in any way.
Se ha repartido, por ejemplo, más que 35 millones de dólares en términos de bono a los trabajadores.
In terms of the fair food bonus, that penny more per pound, we have been able to distribute more close to $35 million to farm workers through this added bonus.
Es una diferencia y es increíble pensar esa cantidad de bono que se ha distribuido hacia los trabajadores.
It's really incredible to think of how pennies really add up to this enormous amount of money, right? And how it's getting to the pockets of people that need it most.
Y ver cómo la comunidad ha cambiado también bastante en los últimos 10 años.
And we've also been seeing a lot of change in our own community as well in the past 10 years because of this program.
Y Mokali antes era la mayoría trabajadores hombres. Y solos aquí en la comunidad.
For the most part, for those who might have ever connected with the Mokali, you know, 10 or 15 years ago, you would realize that most of the farm workers were mostly men, mostly single men, you know, between the ages of 18 and 25.
Hoy en día es diferente. Hoy se puede ver familias, se puede ver una comunidad bastante distinta.
Now we're seeing very different community. Now we see families. We see people who are rooting themselves in this Immokalee community.
Al mismo tiempo, mientras que nosotros estamos mostramos los cambios, mostramos el resultado que trae el programa, estamos viviendo en un tiempo bastante difícil en esta comunidad.
But as we share these statistics and show really the success of this program, there's no denying that we're all, specifically in this community, living through a really tough time at this moment.
Por ejemplo, aquí en Immokalee, no solamente los trabajadores somos considerados esenciales, sino también, aparte que nos han considerado de ser trabajadores esenciales, somos una comunidad que hemos sido olvidado por parte de nuestras autoridades en términos de cómo dar apoyo en las pruebas o cómo apoyar directamente las familias en esta comunidad.
Although our community and our, for the most part, have been deemed essential workers, and although the industry based here in Immokalee has been deemed an essential industry, we have seen that our community, for the most part, has been a forgotten community when it comes to getting resources out that would best protect this essential community from COVID.
Por ejemplo, en el principio de toda esta pandemia, Immokalee estaba olvidado de parte de nuestras autoridades donde no mandaban para hacer pruebas. Se empezó a mandar para hacer pruebas porque la coalición tomó un papel importante de presionar al Departamento de Salud y hasta el punto de traer a los Médicos Sin Fronteras en esta comunidad donde los casos estaban empezando a subir.
Yeah, when the pandemic really started to kick off, April and May, we saw that this community had again been totally forgotten by elected officials and people even in positions in high health positions. There was no accessible, consistent testing that was available for farm workers until the coalition launched a campaign pressuring Governor DeSantis and even went so far as to establish a partnership with another organization that you all may have heard, Doctors Without Borders, that does a lot of international work, but now needed to be doing work in Immokalee because there was no testing here.
Y creo que la parte como bastante, en parte vergonzosa de parte de nuestras autoridades, es que Immokalee no solamente es parte de Collier County y parte de Naples, donde Naples es una de las ciudades más ricas de los Estados Unidos. Al venir en este condado, los Médicos Sin Fronteras, que normalmente ellos van a países donde hay más necesidades.
Yeah.
Al estar aquí era un mensaje bastante vergonzoso para nuestras autoridades por el hecho de que ellos tomaron su papel que ellos debieran haber tomado.
And to make a point, really, this was probably something that should be shameful to our elected officials here in our county. Collier County, Immokalee is part of Collier County here in Southwest Florida, a county that has cities like Naples, cities like Marco Island, very wealthy, very well off, some of the most rich towns and cities in the entire United States. Yet, again, Doctors Without Borders, an organization that typically does their work in third world countries where there is no resources, they needed to come to Collier County in order to help out with testing.
Nosotros como trabajadores siempre hemos dicho que la verdad es la razón por la que las cosas cambian. Traer los Médicos Sin Fronteras es como una presión para el Departamento de Salud de este condado, en donde ellos han tenido que modificar sus horarios, han tenido que reconocer que los trabajadores esenciales, los trabajadores aquí en Immokalee, también buscamos y necesitamos protecciones.
We've always been rooted in the Immokalee workers and the fact that truth is what leads to change. When you see what is truth, what is happening, that allows people to be able to create change. Bringing the Doctors Without Borders here to Immokalee proved to the Department of Health that there was indeed a need, that there was farm workers that were extremely vulnerable, that there were positive cases happening, and that they needed to adjust, that they needed to offer more testing, that they needed to offer more resources to the farm worker community.
Han pasado los meses, y muchos que conocemos que trabaja en los campos aquí en la comunidad ha estado expuesto, y de verdad es un verdadero milagro que muchos de ellos no se hayan infectado en la manera como es el transporte, en la manera como son las viviendas aquí, en la manera de cómo los trabajadores intentan protegerse con las limitaciones que uno tiene.
Yeah, it's been nothing short of a miracle, really, to knowing how vulnerable the farm worker community here is in Immokalee, knowing that when you go to work, as you can see in the image here, you're usually in a filled bus, right, with dozens of other workers. Knowing how the housing conditions are in Immokalee, where people tend to live in trailer homes, 8, 10, 15 to a trailer home, not really being able to socially distance, it's really nothing short of a miracle that there hasn't been a bigger hit and a bigger toll in terms of death and in terms of how many people have gotten sick from COVID here.
Los meses pasan y la temporada aquí en Immokalee ha empezado nuevamente.
And as the months have passed, now the new harvesting season has started here in Immokalee.
Pero sobre todo, ver por lo menos ahora que el Departamento de Salud sí está respondiendo, dando pruebas a los trabajadores.
But now we're finally seeing that response after pressure and after months from the Department of Health to adjust and to actually offer these resources here.
Creo que por lo menos sabemos que esta nueva temporada va a traer una nueva ola de contagios, o ya hay una nueva ola de contagios, y nuestra comunidad hemos estado haciendo todo lo posible de poder protegerlas, de poder ayudar a dar recursos donde hay pruebas, y lo hacemos aquí por medio de la radio que tenemos aquí en Immokalee, por medio de los contactos o cuando vamos a hacer las pláticas en los campos. Les decimos que pasen o llamen a la coalición para saber dónde están pasando las pruebas.
Yeah, we knew going into the fall season and into this new harvesting season that there was going to be a new sort of increase of COVID cases, another wave of increases as we're seeing now nationwide, due to the fact that a new group of people from all around the country were going to come down to Immokalee. We knew that. And so we wanted to prepare ourselves to, again, make sure that those testing resources were readily available for farm workers, but also doing other work, education work. A lot of what we've been doing has been passing out masks, passing out information through our community radio station here in Immokalee, letting people know how to best protect themselves when we go to the fields, giving them masks, giving them a information about if you do find yourself sick or if you know someone who is sick, you can contact the coalition in order to get help.
Mientras que hacemos todo eso aquí en nuestra comunidad, apoyándolos, protegiéndolos con el COVID, nuestro programa ha traído o se está siendo reconocido y al mismo tiempo estamos mostrando cambios de cómo estamos expandiendo a otros estados, de cómo el modelo de responsabilidad social se está utilizando en otros lugares.
But at the same time that we do this work of COVID and stuff, at the same time, we have been seeing a lot of advancements in our Fair Food program. Recently, we've seen the recognition, a new recognition, I would add, by an organization, MSI Integrity, calling the Fair Food program the gold standard, I'm adding, for protecting and social responsibility. But we've also seen the expansion of the program to other states and to other industries as well.
Cada temporada durante el verano hemos ido a 7 otros estados para educar a los trabajadores en otras compañías allá.
Yeah, now for many seasons during the summer, when the harvest season in Florida is over, we have been traveling up north, up the East Coast for the most part. Following the migratory pattern of workers, educating them again up there about the rights that they're entitled to.
Pero al mismo tiempo, trabajadores, por ejemplo, de las lecherías en Vermont han venido aquí en Immokalee, están implementando el modelo que hemos creado aquí en Immokalee en la industria de las lecherías, donde nosotros como trabajadores no conocemos las dificultades, no conocemos su realidad, pero ellos sí lo saben y por eso el modelo está sirviendo para poder proteger a trabajadores allá.
But at the same time that the Fair Food program is expanding, the model of the Fair Food program, as you can see here by this little yellow state here, has been adopted by other workers in other industries as a model that they want to use to clean up and to bring about protections within the industries that they work in. One example of that is within the dairy industry in the state of Vermont, where there's an organization by the name of Migrant Justice that many years ago reached out to us and said, we want to implement a similar program in our industry. There's abuses similar to what there used to be in Florida's tomato industry. And they worked to implement a program now called Milk with Dignity in their dairy farms in Vermont.
Entonces hay mucho que se está logrando con el programa.
And so there's a lot that is being done with the Fair Food program at the moment.
Y el programa de responsabilidad social, cómo se está expandiendo en otras industrias también. Por ejemplo, ya el programa de comida justa se ha expandido en Tennessee. Es que son parte de las cosas que se está logrando con la implementación de este programa.
Yeah, and one of the other things that I was telling Oscar to mention is the expansion of the Fair Food program to the state of Tennessee. So Tennessee, this is the first time that there's a farm in Tennessee that is part of the Fair Food program. So we've recently expanded there, but we've also expanded to another crop or to another non-produce. We've expanded to the cut flower industry in the state of Vermont. So now workers who work in cutting and cut flowers, sort of bouquets and stuff that you see at a local store. They are now also, for the first time, also under this Fair Food Program.
Entonces ahí, ese es en términos aquí en los Estados Unidos, en término internacional, ya el programa de responsabilidad social se ha expandido también en países como Bangladesh y Lesoto, donde han tomado este programa para poder implementarlos en estas en las industrias de allá.
But that's here nationally in terms of what the program is doing and what the motto is doing. But it's even been doing strides internationally. Some success stories include stories within the garment industries of Bangladesh and the garment industries in Lesotho in Africa. Workers there reached out to the coalition saying, how can we learn from the Fair Food Program and see how could we implement elements of the Fair Food Program within our industry to better protect workers.
Entonces hay muchas cosas que se está logrando por medio de los trabajadores.
And so there's so many things that we've been able to achieve even through this pandemic and through the work of workers in all of these different industries.
Muchas cosas que a nosotros o a ustedes que no están directamente dentro de esta comunidad viendo las dificultades, viendo las cosas que se tiene que cambiar todavía, que muchas veces estando fuera uno no está familiarizado a eso.
Yeah, sometimes it is hard for people outside of our community to really be able to realize, right, what change is happening. And what are sort of the issues, the real core issues that someone is facing in their community.
Pero al conocer y al saber sobre esos cambios, debiera de sentirnos orgullosos de cómo es que en este país, trabajadores inmigrantes, trabajadores agrícolas, hemos creado un programa que protege y garantiza derechos laborales más justas, no solamente para nosotros, sino para toda la gente que quiera estar en esta industria. Y al conocer eso, debe ser el motor para que uno que no tiene esa oportunidad de estar en ese lugar y que pueda aportar algo para la campaña por comida justa, siempre estamos nosotros contentos de abrazar a esas personas y serlo parte de la familia de comida justa.
But really, it's important also to mention that these changes that have been brought about to the community, even for those who have been allies, for those who have supported this work, even though you may not have that lived experience of seeing those changes yourself, hearing the testimony from those who have, from the farm workers who are seeing this real protections for the first time, we feel in a way very proud of what we've been able to do, that an organization made up of mostly migrant, sometimes undocumented workers, sometimes indigenous workers, working alongside allies all around the country to create a program that is so successfully eliminating these issues is something that we can really all feel very proud of. If you've gone to an action, if you've participated, if you send a letter, if you have invited CIW to your congregation, you have been part of that process. And so to us, we always welcome with more open arms, right, anyone else who wants to be part of this, because we know that what we're creating is real, tangible change in this community.
Lo digo que uno es bienvenido por el hecho de que nosotros todavía tenemos una campaña activa. Nosotros todavía tenemos que agregar más corporaciones. Porque sabemos que no solamente las 14 corporaciones tienen esa responsabilidad. Tienen la responsabilidad todas las corporaciones que aún no son parte de este programa.
Yeah, and the main reason why I specifically said we are still inviting people is because our work is still not done, unfortunately. There are still many corporations, and we currently have a campaign at this moment, But there are many corporations that have not taken the step towards accepting the responsibility for the conditions for workers within their supply chains. 14 corporations aren't all of the corporations within the food system. There are still hundreds of thousands of farm workers that continue to face the conditions that we used to face in the past.
Como lo dije al principio, muchos nos conocen por las campañas que hemos tenido. Y muchos allá en Columbus nos conocen por la campaña de Wendy's, que directamente hemos estado en esta ciudad, marchando en las calles, invitando a los consumidores a unirse, invitando a la corporación a reconocer la responsabilidad social que tiene con los trabajadores.
And we know that for the most part, a lot of people connect with us via our campaign work. And I know that many of you have connected to us with our campaign work with regards to Wendy's, right? Trying to get Wendy's to join the Fair Food Program, to take a step like all of its major competitors have taken in terms of finally respecting the human rights of farm workers.
Hay mucho que podríamos mencionar, pero yo sé que ya han conocido la campaña de Wendy's. Wendy's no es parte todavía del programa. Lo hemos venido presionando de diferentes maneras. Huelgas de hambre, hemos hecho marchas, hemos mandado cartas. Y ahora, ¿cómo consumidores tienen otra manera de poder seguir apoyando esta campaña?
There's so much that we can go and to talk about the Wendy's campaign, and I'm sure many of you have already participated in some way in that, right? So we don't want to say more, but what we want to mention is that Wendy's is not participating in this program. Wendy's has done everything in its power to try to avoid participating in its program. We have taken many different steps in terms of ways to pressure Wendy's. We have done fasts. We have done marches. We have done multi-city trips. We have sent letters to Wendy's. We have been doing calls to Wendy's and stuff. And the latest way for consumers, for all of us who support this work of CIW to now pressure, the latest way to pressure Wendy's is right now via this Deliver with Dignity campaign that we have here.
Explícalo, ¿cómo funciona?
Yeah, so Oscar wants me to share a little bit about Deliver with Dignity, and I'm happy to do so. So delivery, well, at this moment, first, it's about putting ourselves into context. Right now, during the pandemic, not a lot of us, well, at least not of a lot of us that respect the social distancing guidelines, aren't going to stores, aren't going to restaurants to eat out and stuff. We know that it's a matter of staying at home to protect yourself and your community. And so what right now, what we've realized is that one of the biggest things that fast food restaurants are doing in order to make up this lost business in terms of inside their stores is to focus on expanding their partnerships with delivery companies, specifically the four brands that you see in your screen right now: DoorDash, Uber Eats, Grubhub, and Postmates. During Wendy's shareholder meeting, which I'm sure some of you have gone to before, Wendy's has actually mentioned that they wanted to invest more money into this even before the pandemic, right? That this was something, an area of growth they wanted to invest more money in. And so right now what we're doing, as you can see, is we have a website called boycottwendys.org/deliverwithdignity. And what we're currently asking folks to do is to sign a petition. If you're part of an organization, to sign an open letter that is written to these brands, asking them or telling them that, hey, you're doing business with Wendy's, but Wendy's, there's been a boycott towards Wendy's for the past couple of years, right? And that you should not do business with Wendy's until they join the Fair Food Program. And so this is the call that we have at this moment in terms of ways that folks can support. And I'm gonna go ahead and put it in the chat here. And if you have any questions, more than happy to answer them. But this is the way that we're currently asking for your support. These brands, for the most part, it will not hurt them as much as it will hurt Wendy's for them to lose that business. The main reason is that these brands also do a lot of business with small restaurants, with small businesses, right? In whatever area that they're in. And so losing one restaurant is not that big of a deal, but for Wendy's, it would be a massive hit if any of these brands were to at least voice some concern because people are pressuring them. And so that's a little bit about the Delivery with Dignity campaign. And I know that we're now, well, 10 minutes, so we might open it up para preguntas, ¿verdad, Oscar? Yeah, so we open it up then to any questions that folks may have. We don't just want to talk at you. We want to hear from you too.
Michael, did you want to bring up some of the questions that have already been posted in the chat?
Yes, I've seen three from Ken. I don't know if, let me just put them into the post for Oscar and Uriel. That should do it. Let's see. Yeah. I put three questions or comments from one of our listeners into your chat, Uriel.
So is it I'm sorry, I don't think we're seeing it here. I'm looking at the chat, but...
Michael, maybe why don't you just read the questions out loud?
Are there searchable records of workplace abuse to identify patterns and culpable players? Are you using mobile tech to report conditions and events effectively in a timely manner?
Okay, so let me share. I'm going to share with Oscar, and then we'll respond accordingly. Entonces, I guess the first question is that targeted towards Wendy's. Is that what you're saying? Are there records of workplace abuse that is happening within Wendy's supply chain? Is that specifically who you're asking?
Maybe Ken can unmute himself and ask that question directly. Sure.
Well, I guess we can answer it in both ways. So the first thing, Oscar, básicamente lo que está preguntando es si hay un récord, ¿verdad? En términos de abusos que está pasando y gente que son culpables de esos tipos de abuso en los ranchos de Wendy's. ¿Hay como esa información sobre los abusos que están pasando en los ranchos de Wendy's?
Hasta ahora
solo el reporte que salió de...
hay un reporte que salió, por ejemplo, cuando ellos compraban sus productos en México, pero ese reporte lo escribió uno de los periódicos de California. Ese es como el récord que hay de donde ellos hacen sus compras.
Yeah. So first, I guess to preface it is that information is not often readily available because the business between, you know, a private business between a company and another company is often not public record, and they don't want to make it public record. But one instance that we did see was a report that came out from the LA Times some years ago when Wendy's was purchasing from Mexico at that time, from tomato farms in Mexico at that time. And that LA Times expose showed a lot of horrific conditions that farm workers were facing in farms in Mexico.
Pero Wendy's ha dejado de hacer sus compras allá porque salió a la luz todas esas atrocidades que pasaban en estos campos. Ahora ellos hacen sus compras de tomate en los invernaderos, tanto aquí en los Estados Unidos como en Canadá.
And so, but Wendy's has since, according to them, stopped purchasing from Mexico, usually as a, we see as a response to pressure that we put, because they were purchasing in Mexico, right? We after seeing these kinds of conditions, we took action, to try to pressure them. And now they have announced that they are purchasing from greenhouses, mostly in North America, although Mexico, I would add, is part of North America. But they say mostly greenhouses in the United States and Canada.
Y allí no hay todavía como un reporte que ha salido. Pero pensándolo nomás en la realidad de lo que es el programa de comida justa.
And when it comes to greenhouses, there hasn't been any reports or anything really sort of coming out in terms of conditions for farm workers within greenhouses.
Nosotros en el programa de comida justa, por ejemplo, tenemos todo una estadística de cuántas quejas entran por cada temporada, cuánto de bonos se reparte a los trabajadores, o cómo se hace todas las educaciones donde se escucha. Los problemas se resuelven o se aclara las dudas que tienen los trabajadores.
Yeah, but let's frame that against the Fair Food Program, right? And that's actually part of the problem, the lack of transparency when it comes to what is happening in those farms, right? Under the Fair Food Program, there are statistics, there's an annual report that comes out talking about how many complaints came in, how they were handled, if there were any problems that were found in any farms, and what has been the corrective action plans that those farms need to take in order to address these issues. But those kinds of statistics are nowhere to be found in terms of farms participating in Wendy's that are giving Wendy's or doing business with Wendy's.
Ya, y ese reporte lo pueden ver ustedes, lo pueden encontrar en la página del Consejo por Comida Justa. A comparación, cuando a Wendy's se le pregunta sobre cómo son tratados los trabajadores en los invernaderos donde ellos hacen su compra.
Yeah, and these reports, again, are widely accessible to the consumer, to anyone of us, if we want to go on the Fair Food Standards website, Standards Council website, those reports are readily available. And as a consumer, you can go and see for yourself how this program is working. Yet, if you were to ask Wendy's what for any statistics on how farm workers are faring in their program.
El hecho de que no haya una voz de los trabajadores es como estar como que los trabajadores sigan siendo oprimidos por la corporación que hace su compra en ese lugar.
Yeah, the fact that they have no voice, that farm workers have no voice, no place for them to go to and say, look, these farm workers say that they're doing right, shows the problem, shows the fact that these farm workers still continue to be oppressed and that they're not given a voice to voice any concern.
Entonces nosotros, por eso es que siempre seguimos presionando a Wendy's, a hacer negocios más limpios, a darle una voz a esos trabajadores que están en esta industria, a darles la oportunidad de que hablen si hay situaciones de acoso sexual, si hay situaciones de esclavitud, si hay abusos de robo de salario. Esa es la oportunidad que nosotros queremos darle a esos trabajadores que están trabajando en esa industria.
And that's the main reason why we continue our campaign. So that these workers within Wendy's supply chain have the opportunity to have a voice, for them to be able to speak out against any abuse that they may be facing, and for people to be assured that if they are purchasing something from a company, that they're assured that these workers are indeed being treated fairly and not just taking a corporation's word for it. Otra pregunta que entró es si se está usando la tecnología como para reportar condiciones y eventos en los ranchos, o si hay uso de tecnología en los ranchos. Uh-huh. Tenemos la 24/7, pero no como aplicación o algo, ¿no?
No creo que hay, no tenemos como, no estamos utilizando la tecnología en los campos. Pero una de las cosas que tal vez entra en eso parte de la tecnología es que aquí en el librito, en el derecho de tener salud y seguridad, a los trabajadores les decimos que bajen la aplicación que se llama Waterbug. Eso básicamente para saber cuándo los rayos están cerca, cuándo va a llover, o cuáles son las condiciones en que están trabajando los trabajadores.
Yeah, and so there's not too many uses of technology, I would say, within the Fair Food Program. There are some. And one example of this is under the rights, the Know Your Rights booklet that we give to workers, we talk about those who are a little more in tune with downloading apps and have smartphones to download the application Weatherbug. This is an application that is really good for using in terms of finding out whether or not there are lightning strikes that are hitting or anywhere close to you. The main reason for that is, well, workers should not be working in the fields, or they should not be out in the fields if those are too close, right? And so this is a way for you to find out, oh, you know, if you are in danger, to be able to protect yourself by pulling up this, showing, going to your supervisor saying, look, this is too close, and now you should be pulled from the fields.
No lo usamos para reportar problemas, pero para evitar problemas.
Yeah, we don't use that as a way to report problems, but really to avoid problems, right? And I would add, in terms of other technology, it's not too much technology, but there is a 24/7 hotline run by the Fair Food Standards Council, where workers can call anonymously if they wish to do so at any time. They can. The hotline has Spanish, English, and Haitian Creole speakers, and there is even translators and interpreters in indigenous languages if they wish to do so. So that's one way, really, that we're able to use that. And another way as well is, and this is actually a really good way too, but I don't know how much of a technological advance it would be considered, but in the past, farm workers would be get paid by the amount of tokens that they would have, right? So you would sort of give your tokens in and you would get paid by the amount of tokens. Under the Fair Food Program, there's the implementation of a time clock, right? So as soon as you come in, you punch in, in your time clock, and now you're on the clock. This is something that in the past, in agriculture, for the most part, time would just taken by hand. And so if you know about that kind of accounting, it's just open for any sort of malpractice, right? And so now farms participating in the Fair Food Program must have a time clock. As soon as farm workers get to the farm, they must punch in. And that's a way to eliminate a huge source of what was wage theft in the farms.
Y un detalle sobre eso, que es bien importante porque eso no se implementaba si no fuera por el programa por comida justa.
Yeah, and one important thing is that wouldn't have been implemented had it not been for the Fair Food Program.
Aquí en la coalición hace tal vez unos 15 años más o menos, nosotros creamos un librito que lo llamamos el librito rojo, en donde viene marcado las horas, la hora de entrada y la hora de salida. Y nosotros lo repartíamos a los trabajadores aquí en la comunidad, diciéndoles, cuando van a las compañías, anoten a qué horas entraron y anoten a qué horas salieron, para que si hay un robo de salario, podemos ver cómo apoyarles.
Yeah, and one thing, so I was going to share in a story, is that about 15 years ago, one of the initiatives of the coalition was, there was a little booklet that they would give out to farm workers called the Little Red Book, right? And you would give it to each farm worker and tell them, keep track of your hours, right? Write down as soon as you get to the farm and write down as soon as you get out, right? So that you have your own record of, in case there is any problem with wage theft.
De hecho, tengo que buscar ese librito donde lo tengo guardado en la casa.
Yeah, and so the time clock is a way to eliminate that. And Oscar was like, I haven't thought about this little red book in many years. So he's like, he wants to find his to see if he still has it.
Yeah, son ejemplos y son, es la realidad en esta comunidad.
Yeah, and those are examples, but really it's a reality in terms of what steps you need to go, right, in order to try to prevent an issue. I think I saw your hand, Amanda. I don't know if you...
Yeah, I just wanted to say it's a little bit after 11:30, so I guess I wanted to maybe see if we could wrap it up soon. But one question I had before we did is, So I saw you put in the chat the website for the Deliver with Dignity campaign. Are there any other steps that you would like supporters of Fair Food and the Coalition of Immokalee Workers to take at this time? We can so sign the petition and sign the letter and then maybe share with our contacts. Are there other things that we could do to support during this time?
Yeah, thank you for that, Amanda. And yes, thank you all so much for going over the time, and glad that you all are, for the most part, still here. but yes, and so in terms of how you can support, so besides those campaign steps, one of the main things that CIW is doing is, again, our COVID work, right? And so there's a lot of mask distribution that we're doing, you know, printing of things like this. Hold on a second. Things like this kind of resources, right? Letting people know, right, about what protection to do. This resource here is in Haitian Creole and stuff. And so we're passing these resources all around the community all the time. And so right now, a lot of ways that folks can donate is one of the things that they can do is donate funds to help with this, right? To help with the purchasing of masks. Right now we have a contact that is selling us masks and stuff at a really reasonable price. So we're taking donations for that. We're taking donations for the resources that are going out, you know, to put these resources out. So there's a lot of ways in terms of donations. Right now we have our end of year drive that we're doing, which most of these funds will be going to continue this work of COVID. And really, there isn't, and I would say, too many in terms of campaign steps. As you all know, usually in the spring, we're trying to hurry up and have a protest, right? A big protest, usually in Columbus or in New York, right? But this year we know that because of COVID, we need to be here for the community. And so we're already even thinking ahead of, well, what is it gonna look like to help with the distribution of vaccines in this community? Are vaccines even gonna come to Immokalee, right? And so, right now, our main focus is COVID. And so most of our funds and anything is going, and our efforts are going toward COVID. And so if you'd like to help, that's another way, donating towards our COVID work. You can find that information on the CIW website. I can also send a link to Amanda, to Sue, and to Michael that you can share with a post email as well, in terms of a way. Oh, there you go. Someone found
perfect. Yeah. Thank you, Amber.
Yeah. So that's really the other way at the moment. And unfortunately, we are in a place where our campaign really is kind of at a standstill, because we just need to be here for the community here in Immokalee because of COVID. So, yeah.
Well, I thank you so much for reaching out to us to give us an update about what's been going on. I know Fair Food and Coalition of Immokalee Workers has been so important to First UU, and there's a lot of folks at First UU who really love your work and admire your work and have supported it over the years. So we really appreciate you taking your time during this pandemic to reach out to us and let us know what's going on with you.
Ya, claro, muchas gracias por el tiempo de todos. Sabemos que es difícil de poder estar allá en persona, pero haciendo uso de la tecnología podemos nosotros actualizarles también de lo que se está logrando acá o de lo que estamos haciendo por nuestra comunidad. Siempre lo que va primero en nosotros es esta comunidad que por años, por décadas, ha sufrido no solo los abusos, sino ahora el problema de la pandemia, y gracias a todos por apoyar eso.
Yeah, and so again, Amanda, and to everyone here, thank you all so much for giving us the space, for giving us the time to be able to share with you about the work that we're doing here. We know it's hard to not be able to do these things in person like we usually do them, right? You know, we travel to different communities, but I guess that's another way that we're making use of technology, right? To be able to connect and still share with you all about the work that we're doing. Again, for the most part, as you all know, our main focus is this community, a community that has if you look at it, for all intents and purposes, there's always been exploitation in this community, but that's not because it's intrinsic to this community. That's because it was brought to this community and it is done on purpose. And now we're seeing a new example of that through this pandemic, right? How vulnerable this community is because of the pandemic, because of the lack of resources and stuff. But again, we're always so happy to connect with you all. And we know that with folks like you all on our side, that we know that we can do a lot more to be able to be here and to make a difference. So thank you all so much.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Have a good one, everyone.
You too.
And if you don't have any questions, if you still have any questions, I'm sure Sue is always connected with us. So you'd be able to ask her and she'd be able to put you in touch with us. Thank you.